there are two things I'm learning at this LCA this year. One of them is that normally I go to conferences and I get on an airplane and then I have time to do the slides. This time I've been in Wellington since Christmas and suddenly the conference was here and I was like, oh my God, I need to prepare something. So the other thing is that I just remembered at this conference that there is kernel mode that has entered Debian Unstable, and I didn't actually think about the conference at the time when I upgraded my system. So I think I'm just going to hide the slides, then you come. I mean, this is unacceptable, right? So I'm going to hide the slides. That means you don't see how unprepared I am. And I can blame kernel mode for it. How awesome is that? All right, so I'm here to, is it time yet? I'm here to spend another 50 seconds waiting for time to arrive. So let me shut this off. Okay, I'm here to talk to you about, I'm just going to use this thing. There we go. About a little pet project of mine and ours called VCS PKG, and that is basically an acronym for something like version control system for packaging or whatever you want to call it. We have a website at vcs-pkg.org, which is mainly a collection of resources. So if you're interested in what I'm telling you about now and you want to have more background information about it, then please go and visit this website. Let me start off with a poll. How many of you have heard of this project? So that's a little less than half. And how many of you are using, how many of you are active in packaging for distros, actually? That's a little more than half. And how many of you are using version control systems to do that? A little less than half. Okay, so I guess the trend we can see here is that there is definitely a trend towards version control system packaging, and not many are doing it yet, but many have started. And the goal of the VCS PKG project is to identify this moment in time as sort of the, we are ready to abandon version control systems as we knew them in the last 20 years, and we are getting these new classes of version control systems, the distributed version control systems, and they have capabilities that we can harvest or harness, and yet when we all do our own thing, we're essentially going to be in a situation 10 years from now where we then will need something like the LSB to bring us all back into standards again. So the idea of VCS PKG was to, as early as possible, figure out ways in which we could use version control systems for packaging and then do that in a sort of cross-distro approach, because for one thing, we at Debian do it, the folks at Ubuntu do it, folks at Fedora do it, and you know, every single distro has very smart people working on this, so we can profit from each other. And then more than that, once we have been able to profit from each other, we might actually be able to use those version control systems, the full power of them, and facilitate the exchange of patches. Because when I write a patch for MD-ADM, for instance, why does the Fedora person have to write that same patch again? Wouldn't it be much easier if you could just cherry pick and use all of the powers of the version control system, for instance, conflict resolution, to do that? So who of you here thinks that CVS is the best version control system? I'm actually not going to go down that road now. I think that this is another point. I mean, cross-distro and also version control system agnostic. We don't really want to focus on discussions about whether BZR is better than Git or whether Mercurial is better than Subversions and so on. It's kind of pointless. What we are trying to figure out is a sort of general requirement to version control systems and then figure out a baseline of this requirement and then how you can use these requirements to actually make things happen. So let me just back up. This is not going to be a very technical talk, but it might be a little bit technical. And if you have technical points to make, go ahead and make them. Ask questions during the talk, and find me afterwards if you would like to contribute, and then obviously also join us on the forums. So what we have basically is this idea of a package, right? And in order to create a package, we have upstream source code, and we turn that into a package with something that we call a diff process or something like that, right? So every single distribution will take an upstream package like PostFix and software like PostFix and then make a small number of modifications to it to make sure that the software fits in with the distribution. And some of these diffs are obviously very specific to the one distribution. For instance, I think Ubuntu might be a good example because Ubuntu was one of the first or is still the only distribution that uses Upstart. And no, Fedora does it as well now? Okay. So a couple of distributions are using Upstart, but Apache or PostFix don't actually do that yet. So those modifications you do are very distro specific. Yet another class, so we have distro specific ones, and another class of modifications that you can make to the software are the ones that are actually more geared towards upstream, and those include bug fixes or feature enhancements. And ideally, you kind of want to keep these things separate. What Debian has been doing, and you know, feel free to complement if you have information about this for other distributions, but I think it is more or less the same. What Debian has been doing over the past 16 years is to simply say, take the original source code, produce the package with a single monolithic diff. So a Debian source package up to sometime last year has been a tarball, which is the original source code, a diff, and then basically you would get the deb file out of that. Right. So the comment was from a Red Hat Fedora person who said that the spec file in Red Hat and Fedora has always like referenced patches, as far as I understand, and the patches had descriptions, and then inside the source package you would actually have the patch, and that would get applied in the build process. And this is possibly an example of cross-distro collaboration right there, because it took us, Debian, a long time to actually get to this point. And it's been a rather windy and dangerous road, because we had all these kind of tools, hacks on the way. I don't know, DBS, and then there was dpatch, and now I guess we're sort of more or less standardizing in Quilt. Where, and I guess there's something interesting to be said about this, because in the RPM spec files, the patches are referenced, and that's already integrated in the functionality of RPM. This has not been the case for Debian for ages, and it has actually just now been changed last year. So as of last year, we don't actually need these patch helpers anymore. We now have what we call dpackage v3, and the idea is pretty much the same, that instead of having a spec file referencing the patches, we actually have patches in a directory that which get applied, and then every single of the patches has a description in there. But I think that's a standard difference in paradigms between what Red Hat does with a single spec file and Debian with a directory. All right. So now, once we've established this, once we've established the fact that we are all kind of doing the same thing, that we're all changing upstream software to comply with our distro's needs and package them, and once we've established that we have a different classes of patches, then a whole slew of possibilities opens up. First of all, of course, there's patch exchange. Whether that's just Debian to upstream, here's my bug fix, take it. You know, this is a patch file. It's attested, it's applied, please take it. Or whether it's really cross-distro. Hey, Red Hat has been doing all this great work on MD-ADM. Let me just cherry-pick that patch and integrate it easily. That's the logical next step. Now, once you've done this for a bit, and we have been doing this, I mean, specific software packages like Apache, PostFix, probably glibc and xServer and so on, much more, because they are so complicated that not every single distro is even in the position to assemble a team to maintain, you know, glibc or the xServer or the kernel. So it's been going on there. But once you start exchanging patches, you very quickly run into the situation where you're like, this is pretty cool, but it still requires way too much manual labor. So I obtained this patch from Fedora last week, and it's integrated, and now Fedora actually found this weird bug that causes complete data loss, but only on Thursdays. You know? And so my users never use the software on Thursday, so they don't find the bug, and it's going to take me, you know, and then Debian Stable is released, and then we have that bug in Debian Stable, and all chaos breaks loose. The problem here that I'm trying to get at is that the patch that I took from Fedora is actually not tracked by me. And now, obviously, I could go ahead and write a little script that polls the Fedora HTTP server every 5 minutes and makes sure that I always, or an RSS feed or whatever it is, that I always get the latest patches. But this is really starting to be the domain of the version control systems. And on top of that, the new patch might conflict with what work I've done. And you know how difficult the conflicts are to resolve, or how manual they have to be resolved when patch does it, whereas Git and especially BZR, they tend to have very smart merge algorithms that actually can do a lot more things automatically than what patch can do at this point in time. So once you've gone down this road, and once you've accepted that patches should be separate, then enter version control systems. And this is what the project is trying to do. We're trying to figure out how can we use the version control systems for packaging. Now, I'm prepared to give you a little bit of an introduction into the basic idea that started all of this, which is about 4 years or 5 years old, and which has not really been used yet because of all the complications, and then explain to you why we haven't really been able to go much further than that. In the end, it's a very difficult problem, but let me pick up on that first. So how many of you in the room here have used version control systems at all? Like, you know, okay, wrong question. How many have not? And I don't want to single them out anyway, so also a wrong question. How many of you have used version control systems with branching capabilities and have used branches? So most. Yeah, all right. So the idea of a branch is basically that you say, this is a separate line of development, and you can make changes in this branch. So you have your main line, and then you branch here. You can make changes in this branch, and at some point in time, you might want to go and merge those changes back. And that branch then ceases to exist. This is the core idea of the workflow that we started to use in about 2003, 2004. And it would be to say that this line up here, this main branch, is upstream. And the packaging that I do for Debian, that somebody else does for Fedora, is really just the branch off upstream. So I will call this now the distro branch. And then from the distro branch, you can actually do further branches if you want to do features. So let's say we wanted to add feature A, and we also wanted to add feature B. And let's assume further that we're making a feature enhancement, which I'm calling F, and that we're also fixing a bug, which I'll call G, as in bug. I ran out of B's. Unfortunately. So now what you have is a main line upstream, and you have two branches that are directly of G and of F, and you also have the distro branch and branches of A and B. Why do I even distinguish between A and B and F and G in this case? Well, the distro branch itself is already, or has already, some delta associated with it, because this is what the distro, or Debianization, or distroification is required, and some of these changes might conflict with some of those. So if I have my branch A, for instance, and I try to merge that directly into upstream, I might get a huge conflict because A might depend on some of the changes that I've made for the distro branch before that. On the other hand, the branching of the version control systems gives me the possibility that I can maintain all these different branches separately, and so it doesn't cost me anything extra, other than maybe a little bit of complexity, and I'll get to that point in just a second, to maintain those branches dependent only on the upstream branch. And then they dangle here and are basically available to upstream to use. Now, there are a whole lot of problems, actually, with this approach. One of them is complexity, as I've already mentioned. You know, if you have four branches, this is all fine. Like, you know, it's not very, very hard for you to wrap your head around four branches. But have a look at glibc, for instance. You know, have a look at how many patches we track in Debian for glibc or Ubuntu, and I'm sure Fedora will do the same thing. And suddenly you have 150 branches or even 400. And that gets to a point where it's a little bit too much to expect from a human to actually keep track of all of that. But we have version control systems to keep track of them, but those version control systems, in my opinion, are yet a little too immature. They expose way too much. So what happens now if, you know, upstream says we're going to release 2.0, for you to be able to actually release a package 2.0, you need to go ahead and you need to merge 2.0. Oh, I could have used a different color. Let's use red. I could have gone ahead and, or I would have had to go ahead and merge 2.0 into my distro branch. And then I would have had to merge my distro branch into my derived feature branches and my bug fix branch. So merge into this and merge into this. And, you know, maybe the bug fix is now actually merged into here and I don't need it anymore, so it ceases to exist. And the feature branch, in order for it to be useful, also needs to have a merge from 2.0. Now, these are a lot of manual operations that you have to do and keep track of them, and it's very difficult, and it's, especially with Git, I don't actually know how BZR works in this, but especially with Git, it's not necessarily easy to learn from conflict resolution. There are ways in which you can actually record a conflict resolution, so if you've had, you know, to resolve a conflict at this merge when you merge 2.0 into the distro branch, then you can basically tell Git, look, this is how I did it the last time, so when you run into the same conflict here at A and at B, just use the same thing. But it requires a lot of knowledge about the version control system. BZR might have that more automated, or may not. The point that I'm trying to make is that it's still very, very complex. And also, if we have this, then how are we actually going to create our source package out of it? Because this is all good and well, and as we learned from Bdale just a little while ago, everybody builds from source anyway, right? We're not expected to have stable packages. Well, that was wrong. He was making a joke. And more people were laughing when he made it. So, we can't expect people to just use the source repository and build from that. We actually want to create a package. So the question becomes, how do we build a package from this? Or, if we want to have a patch series in the package, separate patches that are referenced from a spec file or in the Debian patches subdirectory, how do we generate that from this? And this is where we've done most of the work in VCS PKG, is to figure out how can we actually distill this into a patch series. And I can you know, advance a little bit, and I can mention this name here, TupGit, which is a tool that is rather arcane to use at the moment. It's not reached 1.0 yet and probably won't for a long time because there are many UI issues that we have to work out. But the idea is similar to Looms in BZR and also the Mercurial patch queues. The idea is essentially that when you look at the graph like this, it is a directed acyclic graph, you can flatten it. You can do a topological sort on it and basically create a linear series of patches. So what you do is you say, basically, upstream is the origin, and the first patch in the series will be the distro patch, because B and A have to appear after the distro patch because they're dependent on the distro patch. They are descendants of the branch, distro branch, and therefore dependent. And so essentially TupGit and Looms and Mercurial patch queue will flatten this entire directed acyclic graph into a series and then spit out a series of patches, and then you can use something like Quilt. Or you can use the new DPKG v3, the new Debian source package format, to have these packets built into a package, or applied when you build the package, or maybe applied when you unpack the package. there are different variables here and many different opinions, obviously. So let me just, maybe I can turn this over. Golly! All right, maybe I can't turn this over.
Turn it around.
Pragmatics. Awesome. All right, so there was this day, the 7th of May, 2008. What happened on that day? Does anyone remember? No? 2008? No. That day, it became public that Debian had been shipping an OpenSSL library in stable that is slightly problematic. And on that day, at least in Debian, and then also in the VCS PKG project, a lot of discussion on patches started to happen. And that's good, yeah, primarily. Secondarily, it also means that all of the work we've done so far in VCS PKG was kind of replaced by the color of the bike shed. Yeah? So suddenly, we instead of like looking at our graph, I won't turn this around again, but you remember the graph, and trying to figure out how to actually standardize this graph and how to turn that into patch queues and how to build packages from that. Rather than that, we suddenly started arguing whether it actually makes sense to have patches or whether a monolithic patch series isn't, monolithic patch isn't actually all we ever want. There are actually people who argued this. And then people who furiously shot back and they were like, you know, no, because if you have separate patches, then it would have been possible for someone to look at Debian and see this patch introduced by Debian actually breaks MD5 and OpenSSL, and therefore breaks the entire OpenSSL library. And then some people replied to that and said, yeah, well, but OpenSSL already has a patch series before the problem occurred, and still nobody looked at it. And then people were like, yeah, so you're trying to waste more time on converting other packages to use patch series, when instead you should really be looking at other packages, patch series, and looking at each of the patches to figure out whether there is a problem or will ever be a problem. I'm just trying to, you know, replicate Debian mailing lists here, and I'm... The Italians on our mailing list are actually very, very well behaved, you know, so... That kind of stuff doesn't happen. It comes more from the Germans. And they do not move when they... How was the problem noticed? I think Valgrind sec-faulted. And then... I don't know. All I can say in defense of Debian at this point, and I don't really want to be talking about OpenSSL, all I can say... in defense of Debian at this point is that the patch had been forwarded to upstream, who said, okay. Somebody was doing research. Anyway, moving on. let's not get stuck on this. Moving on. We are now, I've tried to explain to you that we wanted to have patches, and that now we have basically discussions in Debian that, and also in the VCS PKG mailing list about whether it makes sense to have patch series in the first place, and then also where and how to create these patch series and what to do with that. And this is sort of still the current state of affair. The idea of taking this graph... My goodness. The idea of taking this graph and flattening it down into a patch series is still out there. And now we're actually, now that you know, dust has settled a little bit, and we've kind of silenced the people who said that we don't need patch series by producing a new Debian source package format that includes functionality for patch series. So, you know, if they don't like that, then what they get in the future is a single monolithic patch inside a patch series. So now everyone is happy, right? So we kind of silenced those people. And now there's an influx of people coming to VCS PKG saying, hey, this is a really good idea, and I've looked at your graph. for 3 weeks straight, and I still don't understand it. And I can't blame them at all, because this is very simple, and they understand that, right? But then I give them an example package, which has been grown along with my trying to understand this.
Is it MDADM?
Yeah, it's
MDADM.
Oh, God. Neil, where's Neil? Upstream is here, too. We've been working on that together. And Fedora and Ubuntu is actually involved, so... And you should have a look again, because we've made it better now. The point being, it's been really difficult for some people to wrap their heads around what the heck is going on in MDADM, including myself whenever I came back to the package after a while. And the good thing about this influx of people who are failing to understand what we've been trying to do is that they actually come up with better solutions. And some of them are now going ahead and saying, you know, this is bollocks. This is just not how humans work. But humans may actually work with Qwilt. A Qwilt is actually easy enough. It might not be easy enough for you, but... I'm sorry, Stephen, I had to do that. Yeah, you get me back later. Sure. The point I'm trying to make is that, actually, if you have this stack of patches, this is something that most of us can probably work with. You know, you apply A, then you apply B, then you apply C, and then you apply D. And if you want to work on A, you first unapply D and C and B, and then you start working on A, and then you have to update your patches B and C and D. It is version control system again, because that's essentially merging and so on and so forth, but it isn't quite as complicated, and you do not drag a huge DAG, a directed acyclic graph behind you at all points in time. Did you have something to say, Robert?
So you list the top git, which is a DAG-based thing, and looms and patch queues, which aren't. Both looms and material queues are directly equivalent
to Qwilt.
True. Perhaps what you're saying is the MDADM is terrible because it's using top git.
It could be. It could well be, yeah. I mean, the difference between...
No disclosures there, Rob.
Nothing.
Okay.
You're not involved with any of this, are you? The difference, and we've had, and I remember we've had this discussion last year at LCA, you and I. The difference is that it's true, looms and patch queue are basically series. They do stacks of patches, whereas Topkit does multiple dependencies, and those don't know how to do multiple dependencies, so you don't get a graph. Or you do get a graph, but it's by definition one that is simpler than all the other ones. And, you know, I think that's awesome that Topkit can do that. It comes with added complexity, but we don't actually know whether we need it yet. I guess that's the point I'm trying to make, so maybe you're one step ahead in terms of, you know, going back to just simply having patch queues. And that's where we're going now as well. It's sort of like, you know, what has become accepted in BCS PKG at this point, that maybe we need to either work a lot on Topkit and introduce this functionality also into the other layers, or maybe depart from that again and try to come up with something simpler. And it doesn't mean that we have to replace Topkit. It's still a very cool tool if you want to use that. But it might mean that whatever we come up with for packaging, like as a standard, doesn't need to involve multiple dependencies and therefore not involve any of these complex graphs. Jeff?
You might be getting onto this. If you've got this simple graph, which includes the distro branch and so on, how do you then share those amongst different distro packages? Because they'll have different distro packages.
Yeah. I can actually head to that right now because, I mean, at the point I was replicating here the state of discussion, and we don't... This is possible to do with Git rebase minus I as well, and it's not very nice at the moment, but that doesn't really matter because essentially we want to find something at a higher level. But the point that you're making is actually what I wanted to turn to next, and then also with what I wanted to end my talk soonish. Oh, my computer stopped. My talk starts in 41 seconds still. Cool.
12
o'clock? Okay, so I have about 5 more minutes or something like that. So this is actually a good way to continue and also end. So now we have, you know, like one standard here, and that might be how Ubuntu does things. And they have this patch queue for the package. And then also Fedora started doing something maybe slightly differently, you know, and then Debian does things even slightly more differently. And simple, nice, yeah, complex, and useful. Help me out here. Innovative. There we go. So what we need to find out is how can we make all of this happen all together, and that involves a couple of things, and that's actually what we are focusing on at the moment in VCSPKG. One of them, obviously, is how do we actually connect them at the top, because all of the version control systems, if you ever wanted to use smart merging, you need to have a common ancestor. Now, how do we do that? We could ask maybe someone like Linus or maybe B. Dale to stamp down the foot and say, this is how we're going to do it. Probably not going to work. We think that this is going to be sort of the next step. Once we come up with a good solution here, then projects will move to that on a per package basis anyway. So we kind of leave that. I guess that depends a lot on upstream. If upstream uses version control systems, then of course upstream should be the common ancestor. But there are many.
That also means you can't share between the three.
Right, right. And we kind of want to make sure that is possible. Exactly, exactly. So instead of focusing on this at the moment, we're trying to focus more on this. And some of the work that has been done here involves specifying standards for naming, namespace standards. So for instance, you will have something Linux is the namespace reserved for all the Linux-specific as opposed to BSD-specific ones, and then we might have a Fedora namespace that holds all the Fedora patches, and then obviously there's upstream namespace for everything that is intended to go back upstream, and so on. So we're trying to figure out what's the sort of minimal level of standardization that we can do here on a nomenclature. Because we don't want to make it too complicated so that people adopt it. And then another thing that we're currently starting to work on, and this is possibly actually how the best way to address all of these complications in terms of how complex is the entire process of taking version control system, flattening it down, and putting out a patch series just so you can build a package, is to build your package directly from the version control system. I know Ubuntu has done a lot of work on that, and I think you guys are doing it by now, or maybe not yet, or something like that.
On Friday, the first test on production of quality hardware, so I'll be working with
them. Okay, so you're about to roll out, and you've done some work there. It's a very difficult problem, because I know that source only uploads, that was what the wiki page was. That was one of the first wiki pages on the Ubuntu wiki. So it's been a long process, and it's a complicated one. The idea then obviously being, you have your version control system, and instead of creating a source package that then is used to create the binary package, you just cut out the middleman, and you basically do it directly. You have your version control system be the baseline for the binary package. And this is something that we're starting to work on at the moment as well, because we wanted to we asked ourselves the question, how do you do this if you're not Ubuntu? And simply because Ubuntu has the advantage of having a technical committee that gets to make decisions that then apply to the rest, at least to the core, and then by extension to the rest of universe at some point in time. We in Debian don't have this possibility. B-Dale is, in the technical committee, but I don't think that any one of us is, a certain percentage of Debian is going to listen to when the technical committee stamps their foot down and says, this is how we're going to do it. So we're basically more or less faced with the challenge of how do we integrate what's already there and all the different preferences, how do we make that happen? And the solution that we're working on right now is to have something, a file that we'll call source metadata or something like that. We don't have a file name yet or anything of that sort, which is a file that is stored in the repository that explains things like branch layout or, you know, like strategy, like VCS strategy, I'll call it, or something like that. Like, do you keep feature branches, or do you actually track diffs in your version control system, and so on and so forth. So a lot of different metadata stored in here. And the idea is then that in the end, you take this file and you actually submit this file signed to a build server. And this build server then has all the information available, uses that information, and builds out of the repository, which is defined in here, and produces your binary package.